ZFS Rocks wird Ihnen präsentiert von Servershop24.de, der Lagerhändler für gebrauchte Server, Storage, Zubehör und Ersatzteile. Und hier ist Ihr Gastgeber, hier ist Christian Zengel. Hello and a warm welcome to CFS Rocks, the German show in English language. First thing is, I'm not an English native speaker, so sorry about any mistakes or pronouncing the word CFS or ZFS or whatever wrong. This is about technique, this is about storage, virtualization, and how to keep your data safe. In our last episode, we showed you the Proxmox server, the server with virtualization that backups itself. So you basically do not need any additional backup, but there are some reasons you want to have an external backup as well. And how to do this with CFS is the topic of our today's show. So go ahead. We are using Proxmox with CFS since version 2.6. When version 3.4 came up, CFS was built in the kernel and you were able to boot up the host as well from CFS. That made it possible to roll back after a failed update or a hacker attack. So since version 4, there was also a replication engine available from the repository, it's called CSync, that made a small raster of versioning. That means, for example, you could keep 100 hours or 100 days with each hour a snapshot and replicate the machine to a second host. The machine is has been created on the second host and also kept all the all the states of the machine. The problem is, on a NAS server, this would be nice. On a database server, everything rotates all the time. And for example, if you have 1 gigabyte of difference from hour to hour, that means 24 gigabytes of difference per day, is not necessarily the same if you only make a version each day and replicate a version each day. Perhaps it's only 3 gigabytes. That's the difference from day to day at all. So it doesn't make sense to keep hourly snapshots from states days or weeks ago. So the second thing is, on newer Proxmox versions 5 is the data replication that replicates the machine to a second host. It also has to be a Proxmox system, and it only keeps one snapshot. It just duplicates everything to the second machine, setting up the virtual machine on the second side. This is very comfortable, but not enough for us. What we want is for the following. We want multiple targets, multiple systems. So we also want to replicate to perhaps to encrypted FreeNAS or a Mac. We want versions that make sense. For example, every 15 minutes keep 8, every hour keep 24 or 48, and then keep 14 days, for example, and 8 weeks and 6 months. So this is a very efficient setup. But to get there, we need another replication and snapshotting engine, and that's what we will explain you today. And for what is this really necessary? Quite simple. If you're losing a virtual machine and the host, you have to get the system up and running on a second host with a virtual machine that is very close to the crash state. And that's what we want to show you today in this show. We have a very big productive machine running here with 12 hard drives. Half of the drives are productive, the other 6 are spare and one of our replication targets. Another replication target is an encrypted FreeNAS on the other side of the fire-protected wall. And the third replication is at my home via the internet, also on an encrypted CFS volume. And what we want to get is the following here. Have a look. We have my, this is not wrong. So we have the Proxmox screen over here. And I want to explain you what we want to get. This is a SharePoint 2012. So let's have a look what's inside. And perhaps we do some modifications. I try to log on as fast as I can handle it here with a remote key. So let's see. password. So this would be incredibly chaotic here. Oh, we have some updates later. So, but just to explain what the aim is, it's not only data we want to replicate any installation and settings on the machine. So, for example, we will do some changes here and give the computer a description that says, obviously, CFS rocks, and we want to keep this. So the second thing is to have a look at our replication engine that's running entirely in the command line here. So we have a look at our shell here. We have two pools here. Zpool list. Oh, we have three pools, but don't forget about this one. This is the productive one, and this is the replicate one. That means if I have a CFS list, it will show up all the data sets here. Let's see what number the SharePoint was. It's 104, so I can make a CFS list. I have to mute the sound here, obviously. To give you an idea how the target is, we have CFS list and grab the machine number 104. And we have the primary disk here, and we have the primary disk here on the second RAID. This one should be swap file drive. So what we want to do is the following. We have a look at all the snapshots. They are doing automatically. We do this with, for example, get written. That shows also the size of the difference, and grab the 104. So unfortunately, we hit some extra results, but the one that we are interested in is the R pool. First, the primary, the working one, the active. And the latest snapshot on this here is, let's see. The latest snapshot is a frequent, 15 minutes. And here, the latest hourly is 12:17. This is 1 hour beyond because this is central European time, and we are 1 hour away from London time, Greenwich. So this one should be the state for every hour to move it on the second RAID. That should be on the RAID 3. We have a look at RAID 3, and the latest one is here, is the same snapshot. So the next thing we have to do is to show you what engines are running here. We have etc cron dot hourly, and we have a couple of jobs here. The first one is the CFS auto snapshot. And this one is snapshotting any data set that's not mentioned, that is, it don't have to be snapshotted. So that means it's active on any, but it's inactive on RPool 3 because it doesn't make sense that you snapshot the productive side and you snapshot the target. Then the second engine will compare the names of the snapshot, and if it realizes that the snapshot names on both sides are the same, it won't replicate. So we have to mention that it should not take snapshots on the remote side. I can show CFS get all on RPool 3. Let's see, data, and then, for example, so as you can see, here are none of the user-declared variables. So there's no variable that's with a double point here. So let's have a look at the same RPool 3, and here you could see you have com.sun auto snapshot false. What does it mean? The script I was running basically makes a snapshot to the time at the time of the activation on of any data set. If you don't want this behavior because it's default, you have to write this one, the CFS, for example, ZFS set com.sun auto snapshot. That's the variable the script is listening to. Oops. And then it's false on rpool 3. That would be the one that set. And this double point here means this is a user variable. So that's the first step. The second thing we want to do is to replicate the thing to another target. This is the script we are using. ZFS backup, we come later to the details, and just get it running. We are starting ZFS backup. And what it's doing now, it's comparing the snapshot names of the sources. They have to be snapshotted. While the behavior of the snapshot script is to basically default snapshot anything he's finding, except you are setting it on false, the ZFS backup script, you have to mention any data set with a variable to trigger the replication. So let's see, it's starting to run. And as you could see, it says, okay, the new snapshot is that one here. And the news on the remote side, our rpool 3, is that one here. And then, per default, it's moving all the snapshots between the current state on the remote, the current state and the older state on the remote side. It's moving the entire data to the second side. Let's see how this is looking like. Now you can see, it's receiving the incremental stream. Okay, it's not the 114 because there are a couple of data sets on it to replicate. And since the last hour, there were two frequents every 50 minutes and one hourly. Same procedure on every machine. So we have to wait until the SharePoint machine is done. Same game here. That's the current snapshot I triggered manually. This is the last hourly snapshot that has been replicated 40 minutes ago. And then he's also removing old snapshots because we are just keeping obviously 24 or 48 snapshots from the hourlies. We will see this later. But you can also see this on the last episode where we trigger the snapshots and set the keeping times here. And you can see CFS does not have to think about and finding out what has been changed. CFS is a very complex system that is setting directly on the hard drives. And if you're modifying something between a snapshot, the system knows to any time what's my current state, what's the different state on the other side, and then it's replicating the data from A to B without any load to find out what has been changed. Microsoft backups, for example, are taking hours for finding out what has been changed. This slows down the systems or crashes the system, and it's not possible to do this at the day when you're working. ZFS replication is running all the time. It also has a little load, but it's very fine to keep production running. That's a massive difference. So we will just give it about, I think this will take 5 minutes, so we'll have a break here, and then we will see the result of the SharePoint server, and we will find out if my modifications I made on the SharePoint machine are transferred to the second system on the same machine at the first example, but on a second RAID. So what we have here is the snapshot on the rpool 3. And since the last hour, it only were 10 megabytes that has been changed on the remote side. So let's see what we have on the Proxmox side. The next step would be to fire up the machine and see if my modifications are active. I set up those machines manually by copying the configuration files I will show later. And the most important thing is this is the productive machine here. And this is my replica machine here. So I have to ensure that when I fire up the machine, The network adapter is disconnected and of course on a reboot that the machine is not auto-starting. So let's fire up the machine here. And this is the same state the machine would be crashed while it's running. So the replica of the SharePoint server is now booting up and I ensured by moving the replication scripts to a safe place that the machine itself is not being overwritten by the next replication task. So this will take approximately 2 minutes and then we will log on the machine and we will see if the modifications I've done in the system settings are present or not. So after another 10 minutes of Windows updates, our system is back up and running. And as you could see, it's the virtual machine, where it is here, 404, not found. And we log on to this machine, type in the password, and we are welcome. And as you could see, Zune is that there's no swap file because we had it on a second data set that is not that has not been snapshotted because it's not necessary. If the swap file is lost, the system is still working. And it's the same state a machine is crashing. So what could you do to say, oh, I have a crashed machine and it's not safe and the database was open and so on? Yes, it is, but you will have 50 or more snapshots per day and one will be working. And the simple thing is just to shut down the database at night when the daily kept snapshot is running and start the database up so you have a clean shutdown database setup in 2 minutes. And you don't need any expensive agents for this. So we will see. What we did is we modified the system name, the description, a couple of minutes ago before the replication and the Windows updates. And then you could see the settings here, it's German, sorry about that. And here we will see, no, we don't want to change this one, that ZFS rocks is here. And this means not only a file has been replicated, so the entire system and its settings, like the registry, installations, everything is inside. So every data set you mark for replication will be replicated to a second site in an open state, but the snapshot is that fast that all the state on the machine is the same. For example, if you have an open database that's running, every file system, every database today is journaling, it's a crash, but it's running. And imagine you just need it if you have a massive crash. So all hard drives are broken or you have a Trojan or something like this. This is the worst case scenario. You also could make a classic backup and you could shut down the database before a daily snapshot or an hourly if you like to. Then you have a perfect backup in seconds. So let's see if the SharePoint is still running. And then we have our SharePoint up and running. And that's interesting. So what you could see here is any mail of Proxmox replications from our script is going to SharePoint. And this SharePoint is setting yes or no to a successful replication by a rule sheet we set up with a workflow in SharePoint. This is explained in SysOps TV episode 77, I think, email verarbeitung with SharePoint. And you could see that it's pretty, it is from 1345. This is a pretty actual state and inside you could find all the, I don't want to save this. Inside you could find all the log files of the last hourly snapshot. So the browser is a little hard to use in this session here, in this Proxmox session. So you could see what happened here. This is set a ZFS auto snapshot, label frequent, keep 4, 15 minutes. And here it says the data says was busy. So perhaps it was replicating at the time. And if there is an error occurring, you have a no here. Vielleicht is perhaps. And so we don't have to to watch every mail the Proxmox system is replicating or sending to us, so we just get if something fails. So the next thing is, you have seen we have a productive machine, and now we have a replicated machine, and you have seen a very complex system like a SharePoint Foundation server is still working after it has been replicated and rebooted in a crash scenario. So the next thing we will show is how the basics work. So how are snapshots working? They have to be replicated. And then we have to use the script for the snapshots again and then for the replication again. And at the end, we will replicate on a FreeNAS system and set up the machine on the remote side. So be patient. So what we will do next is to set up a manual replication on this machine. We keep it with the R-pool for the productive and the R-pool 3 for the remote side. And we say, okay, let's ZFS create R-pool. And perhaps it's also already a test here. It already exists. Let's see. Then we do rocks. So CFS list, and we grab four rocks. Here we are. So this means this is a file data set. Difference between a file data set and a ZVol is you can put files inside, it's mounted, and a ZVol is for virtual machine usage. It's block storage that can be, you can provide it to a virtual machine or to another device. For example, you could copy the content of a ZVol to a physical hard drive or in the other direction. So that means if I'm going to the mounted folder now, so I have to shut down the volume here a little. So you have a mounted drive, but this mounted drive is all alone. I can put a file inside. I can list it, and I can remove it as well. And if I remove this one, is this gone forever? But if I'm touching a file or putting a file inside, here it is, and then I do a snapshot for R-pool, rocks, then the name of the snapshot, snap one. I can list it, I can remove it, and then I can roll back. I can use this one here. And then it's back. And the most important things and the misunderstanding is you can roll back a snapshot as often you want, as long you do not destroy it. Rolling back is not destroying the snapshot. It's a state. So if you don't have any snapshots, you can delete, you can modify anything. It's immediately. If you have snapshots, you always could return to the snapshot without destroying this snapshot. But if you are recursively rolling back, you are losing all the snapshots. They are newer than the one you are rolling back. So for this case, if you have a Trojan alert and you are rolling back 2 hours of your productive system, you still have your replication snapshots with a newer state, so you can roll back the chaotic state to a normal state before the Trojan, and then you could have a look on the replicate system if there are some unencrypted files you still can use. Very nice. So let's see what I mean. Here's the file. I'm deleting it, and then it's gone, and then I'm rolling it back, and then it's back again, and I'm deleting it and rolling it back. So that means here is our file back. And then what I'm doing is I'm touching and say rocks ZFS. That means I have two files, and if I'm deleting it, it would be immediately go away. That's not what I want. So what I want is I want a second snapshot on this state. I'm calling it snap2. Oh, this was my failure. I don't want to roll it back. I want to snapshot it. So, and if I'm doing the get written again and grabbing our pool slash rocks. So the next thing we are about to do is to put the first state, the snap one, to the second rate, and then to make the incremental replication between snap one and snap two as well to the second side manually. To give you an idea how this is working, what we are going to do then automatically with a large amount of data. So let's have a look here. We say a simple command. The first thing is let's have a look at the Z pools again. We have R pool and R pool 3. So we know that we have a snapshot that is called ZFS send is the command, and our snapshot name is the R pool. So again, is the R pool is the rate itself and the first root data set. It's equal and has the same functionality as the other ones, but it's inheriting all the settings to lower data sets. So rocks is our data set, an individual file system. The add is the divider for the snapshot names, and snap one is our snapshot name. So that's the one I want to send. So this is not a, you could put this on a file, for example, but it's not interesting. What is interesting to us is to pipe this. And at the other side, we say ZFS receive. And then this constellation puts the same syntax, the same folder structure of the dataset names on the remote side. You will see the result soon. And then you say, I want to put this to rpool 3. If I would not use the DVF, it would override rpool 3. That one makes the following. Let's see. It says receiving the full stream to the same here. Let's have a look at CFS list and then grab rocks. And as you could see, we have the same state here and here. And that one is a little bigger because we only have the first state here. So now we want the second thing. Let's have a look inside what we want to do next. We have only the first file here, but we want the latest state. And now it's getting interesting how we get to the second one. When we found the ZFS auto snapshot script, we also found very rapidly the ZFS backup script from, I'm not able to pronounce it, it's something like Ada Arch Charity, something like this. And this is the one we were using in the first example. And if you have a look at the word incremental here, there is an explanation how incremental backups are working. So we take this command here and we'll modify it a little for our demands. For the next step, I'm using a notepad. Oh, there's now a notepad with double D. So that's the way we have to do it. And what we need is the name of the snapshot names here and the target. And this is a little more complex than the ordinary task. So what we have here? We have a ZFS send. I have to move it a little over here. So we have a ZFS send incremental. And so this one is the latest on the remote side. So this should be the first snapshot here. Okay? So then here is the R for recursive, that means you will take every snapshot with you that's beyond you and the latest you want to go to. And then you have the latest on local. This is the snap 2. And that's very interesting because perhaps you would expect here that you mentioned R pool 3. No, this is This should be the difference in bytes, and this comes from the local system. So what is between snap 2 and snap 1? Then we have to bring it up to the second side, but in our example we do not use the SSH command, so we only say ZFS receive DVF, and here is the rpool 3. That's the target, and the DVF means that it's beyond rpool 3. So this might be the command we want to use. ZFS send incremental the first and the second, and then go to rpool 3. Let's see if this is working. I'm excited. Yes. And then it says receiving the incremental stream of rpool rocksnap 2 into snap 2 from the rpool 3. And that means that in the best way we have rpool 3 and rocks should have two files inside because we replicated everything. That's a thing you can do manually at any time. If you have between, for example, you make from snapshot 1 to snapshot 4, and you have a snapshot 2 and 3 between, with the E at the beginning, with the R in the middle, it's taking the difference. If you're using the small I, it does not replicate the snapshots in between. So for example, if you have from hourly to hourly to hourly, and you want to replicate daily to daily, you have hourlies in between, it would not replicate the hourlies in between, only the state from one day to a second day, the effective difference, and not the incremental snapshots in between, because we don't need it outside. You know, ZFS is working on vectors, so you don't have necessarily jump to any station. You also could skip and say the vector is going from daily to daily, or the vector is going from daily to hourly, 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 hourly to daily. You can decide what you are getting in your replication. For example, if we are replicating outside from our customers to us, we are not replicating the hourlies. We are only replicating from daily to daily to have fast backup. On the next side, we will see how the script is working. A couple of minutes ago, I booted the replicated system. And the most important thing is, if you are using a replicated system, you have to take care about that no replication is running. Because you have a current state on the remote side, and the ZFS replication is overwriting the current state. So if you normally, if you want to boot a replicated system for testing purposes, for example, you better use a clone. I explained the clone on an earlier episode of ZFS Rocks in German language. So let's have a look at our amazing replication script, ZFS backup from order origin. Orange. So I moved all the files from the offline folder to I moved everything to the offline folder, not to have it running while I was demonstrating this here. So here I have my scripts back. I can remove the offline folder here, and I can remove also the placeholder. It doesn't make sense. Okay. So the first thing, we have the ZFS order snapshot. I explained it. It's snapshotting everything that's necessary, but the ZFS backup script is working differently. Let's have a look at my data sets again. And let's keep explaining with my SharePoint server. This is the ZVOL I'm using in my demonstration. And now have a look at the parameters of this. ZFS get all of this data set, and as you can see, is yes, you have to snapshot this. I have set this for some reason, but it's a received one. It doesn't matter because we have it snapshot anyway, as long as it's not false, and set locally. And that's the most important thing here. I renamed the property here to ZFS backup. The default property from the download is different. So you have to use that one. And the base name means it drops it one folder beyond the target. If you want the entire path on the remote side, you have to say full path here. So you only have to set. So the command would be ZFS set CFS backup is base name for example using this data set. Do you have still it in the clipboard? No. Again. Oh, this was too much. So again, ZFS set ZFS backup is base name, not bus name, base name. Base name. And then you have it in the properties here. And that's the thing what's triggering the replication script to run. How's the replication script configured? It's pretty easy. My colleague Felix moved some lines to have an easier setting up the script. Normally the script is, all the parameters are spread in the first three pages, so it's easier for us to modify it every day. So what are the necessary modifications? It's quite simple. You have to decide what time scheme you want to replicate. In our case, we want to send from the hourly to hourly. Then we have the modified property here. I set in the data set. The one in the downloaded script has another name. Then I have the remote username. In this case, it's root. You have to share the keys before, but we are using on local. We are running on localhost, so we don't need any certificates because we are not using SSH in this case. And then we have the target data set. And what you also have is a PID file. And please remember, if you are breaking the script, if you are stopping the script, you have to remove this PID file. Otherwise, the script is not running then. And that's pretty simple. And then we can just sh cfs backup. Oh, it's not with the sh ending. So we're using it. You have to chmod executable it. And then we will starting the script. The script is looking at any of the data sets if the property CFS backup is set. And only if it's set, it's going to replicate it. So that's a big difference. The ZFS auto snapshot script will snapshot anything. If you have a received flag, for example, ZFS auto snapshot set to false on a data set, but the property is received, it will snapshot it anyway. So if you explicit don't want to snapshot the data set, you have to set it locally. You have to put in the command, say, do not snapshot this data set. The ZFS backup script has to be set manually. It has to be set local. If the ZFS backup property is received on the remote side, the script is not triggering. It will show you what I mean here. So, because the script was not running the last minutes, because I moved it, both states are the same. And in my SharePoint is a trigger. If this mail is coming, a remote snapshot is the same, I get a warning because perhaps the remote side is not replicating. This is especially on a local replication without SSH very complex because. Have a look here on the remote side, this one here, ZFS get all. And you have to watch this very carefully. This one is set to false, and I did it manually after the first replication. That means if a snapshot is coming now, it would not snapshot the remote side, because in the worst case, it's doing on the rpool a snapshot, then it's doing on the rpool 3, then both names are compared, and you have the same name, but the second one is empty and would not replicate. So I don't want, there mustn't be any snapshots on the remote side. And if the remote side is also ZFS auto snapshot running, you have to disable it here. And then here is a ZFS auto backup also received, and the ZFS auto backup script, auto backup script is not using the dataset for replication if it's received. It has to be local. So you have the the property with a double point here, and there is a state. It could be either, you can see it here, you could have a default value from the system. You could have a received one, that's from ZFS replication. And there's also, it could also be inherited. So if you set something like compression off from above, it's inherited to the top. And the ZFS backup script only is acting if it's set to local, because you would replicate something, then it's there, and it said replicate me, it would replicate to itself. It doesn't make any sense. So that's the easy way to replicate all the data sets from here to there. And we also could have a try with our new data set, what's happening. Let's see, what's the time? It's not 17 past the full hour, so we can try this, what's happening. Let's destroy the rpool 3 rocks. This is our manually replicated one. Then ZFS rename rpool rocks. That's the way you move, by the way, this is the way you move a data set to another folder. To up no leading rpool data rocks. So the next thing what we are doing is we are triggering the ZFS auto snapshot. So we did not disable the snapshot feature for this data set. So any data set on the system that's not negative tagged is getting a snapshot to the current time. And the keeping number of hours is set to the script itself. So if you are, for example, you have 24 hours to keep and you're running the script every minute for 24 minutes, you are losing the entire day. So the snapshot now is gone. Let's see, get written and grab rocks. And as you could see, we have all, we have the data set itself here, and we have the first snapshot from here, the second one, and those are remaining forever because there's no engine that removes this state or destroys the state. So I have to do this manually, destroy, and then our tag too much, destroy. This is not easy with PuTTY here. So I have to destroy that one and that one because they are not handled by my snapshot engine. And then I have a frequent that's already set by the system, and we have the hourly I did manually. And then I'm just going to run the ZFS backup, and this will take care about the replication, but it would not replicate. As long I would tag the system to be replicated. So that's what I'm doing, data and rocks. ZFS backup is base name, should be correct. And then I could run my script ZFS backup. This will take some seconds because we have a large number of data sets on it. That also means this is a workflow that's not doing anything automatically. If you are adding a drive, a ZVol or a data set, and you want this one to be replicated, you have to do the following steps. The first thing what you have to do is to tag it for backup, the ZFS backup command, for example. And then you have to run the replication. And at the moment, the dataset is being created on the remote side, you have to disable the snapshots on the dataset. That's very important. Let's see. So I'm breaking the replication here for a second. And as I told you, you have to remove var temp. Otherwise, it would not continue the next time. So could you see this one? Data rocks, used local snapshot is that one. And the other one does not exist. So it's sending the full snapshot, receiving the first one, the frequent. Then it's receiving the hourly snapshot. Here's the performance. And now we have the most important part on this workflow. You have to use this way if you're using a local target for a second rate or if you have a USB hard drive. So let's see. We have the ZFS list and here's data and here's rocks. You could see this one, that's the target. And the problem here is you have CFS get all on the remote side. And it says com.sun auto snapshot is false, but this is not working because inherited is not working. It's only set to local. It means you have to say CFS Z com.sun auto snapshot, same command, false. On the same data set, you only have to do this once for each data set. And then you could see the difference. While here it is inherited, after it's set to local. And that means if you do a second time the CFS auto snapshot, only the source side is getting a snapshot. So it's newer than the target side. The target side is not getting a snapshot. And when you do replication, the source side is newer than the target side. And then he will do replication between both states. We will see. We're starting ZFS backup again. And fortunately, it's the first data set that he's using. So we don't have to wait until the other data sets are replicated. This will normally take approximately 5 up to 15 seconds to find out what the current state is. It depends a little on your load, and my system is very frequent used at the moment. So here we have it, and it says news data, this one, on the local side, on the remote side, this one, and then he's replicating everything in between. And you have the result, the replicated data set. This is awesome. So, and the last question is how to get this all in a target machine. That's pretty easy in a configure target machine. That's what I explained to you. Have a look. On the Proxmox side, the simplest way is to take the configuration file from, let's see, the SharePoint is the one the 104. And what I just did is I moved the file. I copied the file from 104.conf to 404.conf. Then immediately this machine here showed up. I renamed the name of the machine. I did it here, set replica. Then I disabled the auto start. And the third thing is I disabled the network device. So I have a small example on a customer installation, a small I did a couple of days ago. Let's have a look here. This is a very small cluster. This one is a very high efficient machine for approximately 5,000 euros. And this is a HP microserver on a remote side. So as you can see here, what I did, I defined the data stores at the beginning. So for example, this one is RPool data. This is default on any machine. And this is set to all of the host, because all Proxmox installations should have the RPool data. And then we have the RPool tool. This is SSD, for example, or the hard drives. And we have local CFS3. And as you can see, this the local CFS3 is only available on the IP9. So what I did, I replicated all the machines, all three machines, the old Smart Business Server, the replaced has been replaced by the Univention server and the terminal server. We replicated everything on the remote side, and then we set up two virtual machine configurations, and then we just modified the configuration file manually to mention that the new hard drive from the UCS is found on local CFS3, and it's the VM disk 101, even it's the machine 103. So then we disabled the network device and we could start this machine at any time, because on the next hour, 17 past the full hour, it will be overwritten as long as I would not break the replication. As you could see, this is working and starting up. Yeah. And the same is also possible with the second machine, as long as you have enough memory available. So because the second machine is not as potent as the first one, perhaps you want to decrease the amount of memory. So I will stop this again. This is only a simple replication target and should be the best practice you could use. But what if you want the target encrypted? You have a microserver as at the remote site, and you're afraid of getting robbed, or the server could be stolen and the data could be compromised by someone. We have the perfect solution for this, and we could make a freeness a target for replicating. For example, have a look at this here at our site. Is a simple freeness machine. This freeness machine has a couple of customers from us running. And as you could see on almost every data set I'm clicking here, you have the encryption parameters. So what we did is we created the zpool with a single drive, and we checked the encrypted flag. And after we created the volume, we set encryption key, passphrase, sorry, we created a passphrase, and then we download the passphrase. So what we need to use this one, we have to boot up the freeness system, we have to unlock the drive with a passphrase, and if the installation is broken or the system is stolen or the drives are set in another freeness, you also need the replication key. You have to download it, and anytime you are using this key, you have to discard it and have to create a new one and to save it and to keep it. That's very important, otherwise your data is lost. So this should be our replication target, or is our replication target here. And in our case, it's the sysops.ripl, what we are using. And what we just have to do is, oh, this one is still running. I will break this one. Don't forget to remove the PID file. And what we have to do first, we have to SSH copy the key to the remote side. This is this way. And then if you have done it, you will find the key here in the users, view users, in the root user. And I don't want to have our keys compromised, so here they are at the end. There can be multiple keys, it's no problem. And that means I can SSH to the machine root at, you can test it, 50 to 50. That's the thing that must working. Okay, here we are. And that's the basic necessary thing to use the ZFS backup script with a remote system. Then you are modifying Your ZFS backup, I make just a second script. okay, sorry, this is a daily one. Cron.daily. And it's pretty simple, same as before. Normally, if it would, I would send it outside, I would use the daily filter on it. In this case, we are moving all the data to the NAS at night, but usually you would use here the daily one, and then you set the CFS backup property, the name, and here the IP address, then the remote pool. Another PRD file would be a big advantage. And then we have some specialties here. In case of you don't, if you don't want to keep the hourly snapshots in between the daily snapshots, you could do the following modification. Have a look here. You're looking for the variable ZFS send, and then you have a couple of hits. And you just have to change this from a big I to a small one, two times here and here. If you are making this modification, it's just sending from day to day and nothing in between. In this case, I'm doing this. And if you have not a FreeNAS and a Proxmox system, for example, you have a Mac, there is another variable that describes the executable. As you could see a little on beyond, we are not modifying this usually. Ah, by the way, if you're doing here something, if you're filling in something, an X or something like it, you have a try run. That means it doesn't act, it only shows what he would do. So, yes, this is the path of the binary on your side. And there should be on the remote side, so here's the same, should be the same path, and on a Macintosh computer or on different Linux distribution, this might vary. So you have to define the binary of CFS on your side, if you're not using Proxmox, for example, and on the remote side. It's, for example, it's very difficult on a Mac to a FreeNAS. You have different paths, you have to find out where your binary is, and then you could define it here. So this is the remote side here, and that means it's the same as the source side, and this is the source executable of CFS. So, and what it does here is CFS backup, CFS backup to NAS. And in a couple of seconds, we should have some results. And the funny thing was, this script was failing the last days, and we wondered why. Quite simple, we just kept 24 hourly snapshots, and we ran the remote snapshot that's sending everything at my home at first. And that took that long, it took that long that when it was finished and he wanted to replicate on the NAS system here, the common snapshot, the common hourly snapshots are vanished. It has been already been destroyed because we only kept 24. So we changed this now to 48 hourly snapshots. So that means if the the outside backup to my home is done and it's later than 24 hours, there's still a common snapshot to continue. We can have a look here. And that's what's happening here. We are going from a FreeNAS. This one is only running in the morning. And we triggered it right now. So here is, oh, could you see this one? He didn't want to replicate my CFS one. Let's stop this one. Don't forget to remove the PIT file. If you're canceling, oops, this was a mistake. Let's scroll a little up here. Yeah. Newest on local snapshot. Could not open SysOps REPL slash rocks dataset not exist. Okay, that's my fault. We just don't care about it. And that's also interesting. He's complaining about a property value. The thing is that Freenas and Proxmox are not running the exact versions of ZFS. So if you are running a version Proxmox 5 or 5.1 before November 2017, you have a very old version of ZFS, and then you could replicate to a Freenas system, but you're not able to replicate back. I recommend, and that's the reason for the late show, I recommend using Proxmox version 5.1 after November 2017 and a latest version of the Freenas version 11. And then you should have ZFS 072. This is date end 2017. If you have questions, just leave a comment. It's not easy. So what we showed you now is how to replicate by ZFS backup to different systems, and that's a big advantage. If you are using Freenas and replication, you only could replicate from one source to one target, or many sources to one target. This is too bad if you want to have a local copy and a remote copy. We had some tries with making a snapshot on Freenas at the source, replicating to a second, making another snapshots and replicating this to a second one. This is not very satisfying and not reliable. We have the storage replication from Proxmox. That's nice, but it's not interesting to us because it doesn't keep any snapshots. We have the C-sync from Proxmox. That doesn't make us happy because it only can replicate to one target. It has to be a Proxmox. It has to be in a cluster. You could use this if you don't want to get in touch with the command line, but we are professionals. We don't use that as well. So this is our workflow that allows you to make a very granular setup of snapshots and many different replication targets. And this is very efficient, and we're using this for 4 years now, and it's highly recommended by us to use it. If you are not familiar and you don't know how to set up and you're a company or IT company, please don't hesitate to get in contact with us. We can make you an offer how to assist you with your current projects. It's not very expensive to book us for a couple of hours and to save years of trial and error. And we provide now for this solution almost 5 years of experience and almost 10 years of CFS experience at all with Freenas and other systems. So don't get stuck and do it alone. Get help from us if you like to. We also want to say thank you to our server shop 24DE sponsor. And perhaps you have a look at their website. They have tons of server systems and storage enclosures and hard drives and switches and cables and everything you could imagine in the network world. That makes this here a little easier for us with demonstration hardware and some other support from them. If you need help, do not hesitate to get contact with us. You could send an email at christian@sysops.de. That's the easiest way. You can leave a comment in YouTube. You can make a subscription here in YouTube. You can tell us about your experiences. You can ask questions and ask compatibility related questions and things I did not tell you the right way or something I missed. I don't have an idea what will come up in the next YouTube comments. Thank you very much for the massive number of thumbs up and very interesting comments. And welcome to our English-speaking viewers. And thank you for our German speaking viewers. They are still in touch with us. I think if you're an administrator and using CFS, you should have enough English knowledge to understand my poor English. Yes, thank you very much again and say goodbye with CFS Rocks. And we'll see you soon with another interesting topic. And perhaps we're talking about photographers on a Mac with Lightroom and CFS RAID. This will very be interesting and should come pretty soon. So goodbye.